So I figured I'll start by warming up the brain cells a little bit. Make sure you guys are awake. So here's the position, white to play. I'm not even gonna tell you what you're trying to do, so. Just figure out what you do as white. If you think you have it, raise your hand. All right, how about you?
Rook H3, checkmate.
Ooh. Ooh. Oh, what happened? Have a seat. It's not checkmate, all right. So think a little bit more. Black is a very powerful threat in this position. Yes?
Black is going to move his pawn to A1, which would give him a queen.
Right. So do you want your opponent to get a queen?
No.
No. So your move should be pretty powerful, right? Because your opponent's threatening to get a queen. Yes?
I actually think rook H3 might be a good move.
Oh, yeah? Tell us why.
Check. Because rook H3 check. Because black can only do bishop takes H3.
Correct.
And then G3 is checkmate.
It's kind of embarrassing. So, yes, this is the correct answer. Very nice. So, I have a question for you guys. How do you spot a move like this? In the first place, because remember, during a game, there's no one like me telling you white to play and find a good move, right? So how do you spot something like this during your game? Yeah?
Ask yourself what forcing move you can do.
Exactly. You can call them forcing moves. I usually call them tempo moves, but it doesn't really matter. The main thing is always ask yourself what your opponent's tempo moves are and your tempo moves. Can anyone tell me what exactly a tempo move is? Captures are tempo moves as well. So you look at your checks, your captures, your threats, right? And you look at your opponent's captures, checks, and threats. If you manage to do this every move, you will become instantly much stronger chess players. Now, it sounds like something that's easy, but lots of positions, there aren't that many things you can do, right? A lot of positions, the best move is not a tempo move. Most of the time, it's not. But you always want to be on the lookout. Rook H3 check is an easy move to spot, right? Because it's a check. So is rook g4 check. But what the mistake most players make is that they say rook h3 check, bishop takes rook, and then they stop. They're like, I just lost a rook. Why would I do this ever? But if you do that, you will lose this position because you're going to let black queen, and black's going to win the game pretty easily, right? But if you think a little bit harder and you say, okay, let me think a little deeper. You only stop, actually this is a good question to ask you guys, when do you stop? When your opponent takes all your pieces? No. When do you stop?
When you've accomplished what you want, your goal.
Okay, but remember, most variations of tempo moves, are you accomplishing your goal or are you just giving away pieces? Most of the time you're just giving away pieces and then you stop. That's no big deal, right? As long as you don't play the move, there's no harm, right? But your goal, of course, is to find either a checkmate or something really nice, right? And if you find that, then you can stop and play the move. But you want to make sure you only stop when you're out of tempo moves. So for example, after rook h3 check, bishop takes h3, you're not done yet because you still have a couple tempo moves. You could play pawn takes bishop. Did that accomplish anything? No. Then you can stop because that's bad for you. But after g3, which is a check, you should look at it. And if you notice it, you'll probably notice that it's checkmate too, right? But the only way you'll find this during a game is if you force yourself to look at tempo moves and not stop till the end. Does that make sense to everyone? All right. And this one is white to move. So take your time. There is no rush on any of these. All right, so your first instinct to give away a rook? I like that, actually. If your first instinct is to give away your pieces, you're on your way to mastery. So, what, do you have a follow-up in mind?
I think I do have a rook h5. Black's only move is b takes h5.
Mm-hmm.
And then knight f5.
Okay. then my king moves back to h7, for example. I have a slight question. Before, when you look at these problems, and this is something I want you to get into habit, a lot of people, when they look at problems, they get in problem mode. They're like, all right, let me find the tactic, let me find the idea. But it's a good idea, if you want to use it for training for your games, look at it in a few ways, at least, like a normal position. If you're given a normal position, say there's nothing good here, you have nothing special. What do you do first when you see a position that you haven't seen before? Yes?
I found the answer.
Okay, but can you, before you get to the answer, can you tell me what you what you look for in a normal position, yeah?
You look for what the opponent has, all of its attacks, threats.
Okay, but even before that, say, like, yes, you always look for your threats and your opponent's threats, every position. That's a good habit to get into. But before that, first of all, what's material? Because keep in mind, you're going to think about the position differently if you're up a queen, right? If you're up a queen, you're like, all right, let's find the simplest way to win the game. You don't have to be do anything fancy, right?
Yeah.
You're up a queen. If you're down a queen, it's like, oh my goodness, I better do something amazing, right? So figure out whether you're up a queen or down a queen before you start looking at a position, right? You should know what material is. You should know, all right, is my king open? Is my opponent's king open? Figure out what's going on before you try to solve anything. It doesn't take long. It'll take you, what, 30 seconds? But that 30 seconds will make figuring out a problem or figuring out the best move in a normal position much easier. Does that make sense to everyone? All right. So what's material? Speaking of down a queen, what is material? Yes?
Black's
a queen up. So are you just going to play some normal move here?
No.
No. You have to find something pretty nice. So now you start looking at tempo moves. As you pointed out, you can put your hand down. As you pointed out, the most forcing tempo move is probably this check, because black only has one response. Right? Okay. So check. Now this is another easy mistake to make. Let's say you're calculating here. And you're calculating, you're like, rook h5 check, pawn takes, knight f5 check, oh, this looks so good, king h7, knight takes d6 check, king moves, knight takes queen, oh, I'm on a roll. It's easy to just do this without stopping. If you learn to pause after each move, you will make half as many errors as you do if you don't do that. At least, probably more. So you play rook h5 check, pause, take a breath, pawn has to take, right? Pawn takes. Now, pause. What are my checks? Knight f5 check, bishop g5 check, g5, right? Let's look at each of the checks. g5's mate. I don't have to go any farther, right? If you don't pause, you're going to be like knight f5, knight takes d6, all sorts of stuff. It's going to be crazy. You're going to be sitting there with your head like this, right? But if you took that pause, take that moment, you're like, oh, g5 is checkmate. You're done. You can go have a coffee, have some lunch. The game is over, right? You don't have to burn your brain cells trying to find some huge win of material after knight f5 check. So take that pause. I'm telling you, you'll save time. It doesn't take time, it saves time. I'm going to give you another one, which is in a lot of beginner's books. So okay, very basic position, of course, and it's white to play a mate in 3. If you've seen it, have any of you seen it? 2. All right, so you guys can put your hands down. But it's the same concept. You will solve this if you simply play the most forcing tempo moves. But it's actually not so easy to figure out what they are. So ask yourself, purely in tempo moves, how many moves does black have here? Say it's black's move. How many moves? This should not take long to figure out. Yes.
5.
So, most forcing move means you limit black's moves as much as possible. How would you do that? Yeah?
Rook to f1.
So, you play rook to f1, you take away 2 squares, and you leave 3. Right? Can you do better than that? Yeah?
King to f6.
If you play king to f6, you take away 2 squares, but you leave 3, so the same, right? You can do better, yeah? Oh, yeah, then no. Yes? Take away 3 squares, allow 2. King to e6 is your most forcing tempo move. Doesn't seem like a forcing tempo move, does it? But in the end game, it works differently. So, say the king moves here. Now, most forcing tempo move. Yes. Right, it is not a check. A check allows 3 options. Rook to c1 allows 1 option. Your most forcing move is rook to c1, not a check. King here, and now, of course. So again, a very basic problem. But if you think about it in terms of strictly tempo moves, limiting your opponent's options as much as possible, in the end game, that often means not playing any checks. Keep in mind, there were no checks here, right? No checks whatsoever. But you were still able to checkmate in 3 moves because you took away your opponent's options as much as possible. Black to move. Or white to move, sorry. Black to move would be easier. Yes.
King c5.
Uh-huh. So king c5, so this is actually another example of what are the most forcing moves. Basically, there are several moves that only give black one move, right? And they're all kind of the same. So if you look at this problem and your approach is, what is black's next move and how do I want to respond to it, it becomes the easiest problem in the world to solve. So king c5, why is this such a good move? Yeah?
He only has one move.
There's only one move, right? Pawn up. And then this is simple checkmate, right? So it looks like kind of a sneaky move, but really, if you look at it from simply the point of view of what is black's next move going to be, it becomes very simple, right? Whereas if you just try to look for checks, like b4 check, king b7, trying to force everything, not going to be so easy, right? So sometimes tempo moves have nothing to do with making threats. It's often simply, OK, what is my opponent's only move or only idea? And then figuring out what's going on. All right. Next, I'm going to show you 3 problems that are all related. They will not look related. The first one, again, I apologize for this, but this is one you a lot of you may have seen. Some of you may not. Maybe you haven't. But it's a very, I'm just joking. I have a sense of humor. So, how many of you have seen this position? Nobody, yes. All right. Very famous endgame position. So you guys are going to solve this, then a slightly different position, and then a mate in 50.
Whoa, no.
I'm not joking. Yes. King to e6 looks like a logical move, right? By the way, probably your most forcing move, apart from pushing the pawn, right?
Yeah.
OK, here. Did you have a move in mind afterwards?
No.
All right. Our first lesson, always have a move in mind. Don't assume your opponent's going to resign after your brilliant move. Have a plan. Yes?
King f5.
King f5. All right, I'll play up. Go back. You got to go back, right?
Yeah.
And we're back towards that. So this is what I like to do this actually in my lectures. It seems very scattered, but the idea is before I gave you what? What did you do in the previous problems? Did you win a pawn? No, you checkmate it, right?
Yeah.
Do you think you checkmate here?
Yeah.
Yeah? Whoa. This is a checkmate? Well, maybe in some like 10 moves or 15 moves. But no, it is not a checkmate. You're simply trying to either win this pawn or queen your pawn, right? So your goals change, but this is the thing. During a chess game, you have to be doing the same thing. You might go from on the attack to an end game, right? You might be ending up a pawn after attacking your opponent all game. You have to be able to switch gears. You're not trying to checkmate now. You're just trying to win the game, that's all. You have to figure out how to get by Black's king. How to either win this pawn or force a queen. See what I mean? So you guys have to change gears quickly during the course of a game. And also when you're solving problems sometimes, yeah? All right, we've done this. We've been down this road, but let's travel it again. Don't apologize. We all get problems wrong. I do it all the time, every day. Many times a day, often. Yes?
King E6.
All right. Another road that's been well traveled, but hey.
Pawn F7.
All right, we have an aggressive player. I like it. King back. What's your move now? It's okay. This is a tricky problem. It's actually one of the oldest chess positions, but yeah. Wow, you're just trying everything. Unfortunately, after King D6, I'll play up, and now you're gonna go back, and then I'm gonna go back and laugh at you. So, yes, do you have a new idea?
Yeah.
All right, let's see it. Don't be shy.
King E4?
Are you just trying squares you haven't tried yet? Or do you have an idea?
I have an idea, but I don't know which Let's square see to like put it. So I'm just
all right, so King E4. Yeah. So first of all, if I play up to F7, what happens?
Then he's threatening our pawn, so then we can play King F5.
Mm-hmm. And now if King back?
Then King G6.
Very nice. And if you win this pawn, you think you're going to be able to win?
Yeah.
Not a trick question. Don't worry.
Yeah.
Two pawns win pretty easily. I mean, you take this pawn, then you come back, and Black cannot stop these two pawns. Not a chance. You can either bring your king around, you can distract him with one of the pawns. You have a million ways to win. A million's a slight exaggeration. I exaggerate a lot. However, I'm not going to be quite so accommodating. After King E4, I'm going to play back here. So now if you play up to F5, I play up to F7. You're not going anywhere. So?
So, King F4?
King F4. All right, I don't know what you're doing. So if I play here, you come here, you're going to win, so I'm just going to go back. La 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 la. Now what?
King E5.
Oh my goodness, we're in the same position as we started.
Yes, it's black to move.
Very nice.
It's called triangulation.
So, remember, the end game. Do you always want it to be your move?
No.
So this is called triangulation. This is actually how you solve this. And believe it or not, black has no good move here. King F7, King F5, we've all seen that before. We don't have to see that movie again. So say King E8. King G8's the same, basically. King E8, now what? Yeah? King F8. It's all the difference when it's your opponent's move, right? Now all of a sudden it's easy. Next move? Someone who we haven't seen for a while? Yeah, there we go.
F7.
Good move. Next. Yep. Champ. Oh my. You're the slam dunk champ. I never would have guessed. King D7. All right. King over here.
Oh.
Oh. How many of you want a queen?
Not
right now, do you?
Not on the point.
You play here first, then the king goes back, and then you queen. Very nice. But that's why you always look out till the very last move. You do not relax until your opponent extends their hand in resignation or you checkmate them. Until that point is reached, you never relax. 1 second of relaxation can take away like hours of work that you just did.
Whoa.
So yeah, it's happened to everyone.
Yeah.
I've had one moment of relaxation at the end of the game turn a win to a loss.
Yeah.
That's part of chess. It's brutal, but always pay attention. This position was reached in the last round of the U.S. Women's Championship. I believe it was 2007 or 8. I think it was 2008. U.S. Women's Championship, the last round. They weren't playing for first place, but they were playing for lots of money. I think the winner of this game would take third place or something. So quite a bit of money, very important game. The person playing white, I guarantee you, knew the position I just showed you. So you guys are aware of it? She was aware of it. The question is, can you succeed where she failed? She failed to win this position as white. But you guys will not fail. I will not let you.
It's a little different.
A little different. So first, the key is to figure out what is different and how to adapt to it. And once you've solved this, you'll be ready for the mate in 50.
Whoa. It has to be game.
Hmm?
It has to be game.
It's not a game.
What? I'm not.
Don't worry about it yet. Solve this one first. Yes?
F4.
F4. Someone wants to get the position we saw before, right? So if I take you, you take me, you're in your zone, you're happy, right? All right.
Boom.
Now what? Didn't count on that, did you?
No.
This is why. And then if king moves back, my king moves up, you're not going to win, I'm afraid. So this is what I mean. This is what I call wishful thinking analysis. My coach used to accuse me of this all the time, and he was usually right. What it means is I'd analyze going, man, I'd love it if I played here and he took here and I took here, I'd win. But don't assume. Assume your opponent is your worst enemy. They're trying to throw everything they can at you to not let you win, right? So after pawn to f4, you know if pawn takes pawn, it's a win, right? You guys have the knowledge now. So assume they're trying to mess with you. They don't want you to win, right? So they're gonna play g4. They're going to do anything they can to not let you win. Does that make sense? All right. All right, how about you?
King e6.
All right, so king e6, I'll play here.
Pawn f7.
I'll play here. It's okay.
King f6.
All right, we have an almost stalemate. I'll play here. So you have two choices. You can take the pawn and we agree to a draw, or you could not take the pawn and you can lose. What would you like?
I'll go for the draw.
All right. Unfortunately, not a win. Yeah.
King f5.
All right. See, when you guys pause after I play an only move, I wonder how far ahead you're looking. Always look a little farther ahead. Push yourself to look farther ahead. Because if you pause after I play king f7, I don't know what else you wanted me to play there. So if you pause after I play king f7, it means you didn't do a good enough job in calculating. So it's okay. We all calculate lazily. Trust me. I've done plenty of it. But try to work a little bit harder. Make sure you look at one more move deeper. See what I mean? Because here you can't really do much.
Yeah.
So. Yeah?
King e6.
All right. This looks familiar. Is it deja vu? Maybe. I don't know. All right, here. Do you have a new idea?
King e5.
Okay.
Oh,
okay. So I'm going to give you guys a slight analogy. I'm trying to think of a good analogy here. Let's say you have a nail. You want to hit it in. What do you use?
A hammer.
A hammer. Now let's say you have a screw. What do you use to put it in? A hammer? No. Do not use the same tool for every problem. Here, you're trying to get triangulation, right? You're trying to use the tool you know, the tool I just showed you. That's not how it works. Pretend you have a whole belt of tools. You have any tool you want. figure out a different way to win. Because triangulation is not how you win here. So throw away triangulation for now. Try to figure out other moves. I'll give you a hint. Tempo moves are useful, as they often are.
F7.
Oh my. Giving me a pawn. I love when people do that. All right, so I'll take your pawn. Don't laugh at him yet. What's your next move?
F5.
Oh my. Opposition. So I go here, otherwise I lose my pawn. Now what?
King to E6.
Very nice. I go here. Keep going. You're on a roll.
King to
F6. Mm-hmm. I go here, trying desperately to hang on to my pawns.
King to F7.
Uh-oh.
King to G6.
Very nice. Piece of cake, right? There's one more thing you had to see, by the way, which is that after F7, what happens if I play here? I'm all sneaky on you. So don't assume your opponents have to take your pawns. This is a common error, actually. Yes? I'd like to make it a rook, but or a bishop, maybe. But OK. F8 equals something, takes. King F6, game is over, right?
Yeah.
See how easy that was? The only way you found it, though, was because you did what?
Use a different tool.
Use a different tool. Don't assume the one tool you have in mind is the one you need, right? This is a completely different position. I put two pawns on the board, position changes completely. You have to win pitching the pawn and then getting the opposition. Very simple tool. Without this, how's that going
to
work? Yeah, it's just a draw, right? You can't win with just an H pawn. But if you add this, piece of cake, right? So you see how you have to try to approach each position a little differently. All right, I think you guys are ready for the Matin 50.
No.
Here we go. All right. Have a good time.
So white to move
Matin 50. However, you guys can use what you just learned to solve this. Oh yeah? You think I'm joking, which I often am, but not here. So first, you have to figure out what's going on. So take a moment. Can any of these pieces move? Pawns, can any of those move?
No.
They have nowhere to move, right? They're going this way, remember.
Oh.
What happens if my bishop moves? Say I move my bishop here. You have a very strong move. Yes?
Queen takes g1 checkmate.
Queen takes g1 is not checkmate. I'll play pawn takes queen and get another queen.
Oh.
Yes?
Knight takes f2.
Knight takes f2, and that's his mate, because the queen's pinned. See that? So, what moves does black have? Black only has one move that doesn't just lose, basically. Oh, you can. And then I'll play queens with check.
Oh.
Let me give you a hint. You do not want to ever move that queen. Look how much material black has compared to you. By the way, the rook is defended, so you know.
Oh.
Remember, the pawns are going this way. So you do not want to ever move your queen or ever move your knight. If you move your knight, I can move my bishop, right?
Yeah.
You have no mate. And once I start queening my pawns, you're going to be in big trouble, right? So you can't move your knight, you can't move your queen. What's the only piece you can use?
King.
So you have to win the game entirely with your king.
Oh God.
Best of luck. I'm going to take a nap. You guys can wake me up when you've solved it.
This is hard.
It's not as hard as it sounds, trust me. It's just a lot of moves. But all you need to know is the concept that you guys already know. Oh. We have people who solved it already. Mega geniuses in the audience.
I can only tell the first move.
What is it?
King takes h7.
All right, king takes h7. Bishop check. Good night. You're done.
Oh, you have to stay on black squares.
Right. You move to a light square, my bishop moves with check. You're done for, right? Who cares if I lose my bishop? I just start queening my pawns left and right. You have to keep me paralyzed. And this is a good rule of thumb, by the way. If you have your opponent paralyzed, think long and hard before you let him out, right? Okay, if you have your opponent paralyzed, even if they're not up all this material, keep them paralyzed as long as they can. Because oftentimes paralysis can win you a game because they have no moves. They have to just make bad moves, right? So when you have your opponent so that they have almost no moves, really think long and hard before you start giving them moves. So do not let me check you with my bishop. Yep. Now let me show you the problem. What would win you the game pretty easily if you could play what?
King G6.
If you could play king to g5 and take my rook, right? But let me show you. King here. King here. King here. King here. King here. King here. Now if you could say black to move, you'd be winning. But it's your move.
Black would have to keep on doing that because the eighth pawn is it.
Eventually, but this is going to run out of moves, right?
Oh, I keep on getting confused.
It's all right. We all are confused.
King A5.
King A5, rook here.
King B6.
Let me end some suspense for you guys. If you just move your king around all these squares and come back, you're never ever gonna make it my move.
Yeah, on the black square. We need a black and white square.
It's hard to win chess playing checkers. But figure out, there's something you guys have can figure out that'll make this problem very easy.
What if I'm bad at checkers?
Huh?
I'm bad at checkers.
It's okay. This isn't quite checkers. The second you put your king on a light square, my bishop zaps it. The second you let my bishop move with check, you lose. It's not even a draw, you just lose because I queen every pawn.
Oh yeah, you've got F1.
I have a big army. Let's just put it this way, you are outnumbered. You gotta make it so my army can't just crash down on you. Do you have a plan?
Yeah.
What's your plan? Do tell me.
No, I'm not going to tell you.
You're going to try to trick me? That's what this has come to? All right. Let's do it. King d4. Here. You know my move.
King d3.
Oh, here's c3. Sorry. I got confused.
King d2. That work.
First of all, my pawn would take you.
King e3.
You really want to take this pawn? I would advise against it. I'll take your knight, then queen my second pawn with check, and then the house falls on you. Let's go back here. Now, I want to bring you guys back. Remember the hint I gave you. Use your previous knowledge, which I just gave you. What was the first king and pawn endgame you saw? How did you win? Triangulation. What did triangulation do for you in particular?
Hold on.
What in that other position, what did triangulation do for you?
It made what? To move black to black.
Right, it lost you a tempo. Imagine if you could triangulate here. Say you make a triangle and come back here, and it's black's to move. Black's going to run out of moves, right?
Yeah.
The problem is, how do you triangulate if you can't go to a light square?
Actually, there is one light square that I can go to.
Which one is that? Trust me, if you have this right, there's nothing I can do to change it. Remember, chess isn't about hiding stuff from your opponent. Your opponent can see the board just as well as you can, yes?
The only triangulation area would be the A8, A7, and B8.
Aha!
Because A8 is...
So show me how it's done.
So then, King A5.
Rook back. Alright, so King A5, Rook here. King B6, Rook here. Can everyone see how this works?
King A7.
King A7 here.
King A8.
The only square my bishop cannot reach.
Yeah.
Right?
King B8. And King A7.
Okay.
A5.
Dance around one more time. And? All right. What do you think? But did you notice how you use the knowledge from that basic king and pawn endgame to actually solve this? So what it means is that when you're playing chess, learn everything you learn like this. Triangulation, pitching the pawn to get the king in, this kind of thing. Like, just put it in your bag of tools. You should have a whole set of tools. But the more experience you get, the more tools you have. So you look at a position, you look at a problem, and like, all right, which tool is best? Should I look at most forcing tempo moves? Should I look at checks? Should I look at trying to lose a tempo? Should I look at trying to do this? The more tools you have at your disposal, the easier you're going to find solving any type of problem or any type of position.